Allahu Akbar.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu. Welcome to, and if you're joining us from the beginning, the Dawah Conference of ICNA. So my name is Yasser Aslam, here from the Gain Peace office in Chicago. So without further ado, I do want to let you know for this program, the title of it is Dawah Reimagined. So without further ado, I'm going to introduce our first speaker. Assalamu alaikum, brother Mustafa Hijazi.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Now, if you're comfortable with, is it okay if I read your bio? I know sometimes I don't want to have anyone throw dust in anyone's faces. How is it in New Jersey?
Oh, it's great. Can't complain, alhamdulillah.
Alhamdulillah. Chicago to New Jersey, alhamdulillah. You know, and we're going to do some more as well, too. So, Professor Mustafa Hijazi is an educator and researcher, a public speaker, and an advocate for Islam. He has a Bachelor of Science and a Master's in Science and Biomedical Engineering, and also teaches as a professor of engineering sciences at local colleges. He has studied at Miskah University with Sheikh Hatim Al-Hajj and Sheikh Muhammad Salah and many others. Professor Mustafa has held many Dawah workshops, Islamic dialogue, at events, Friday khutbahs, sermons all across the United States for the past 7+ years. He leads in the field of Dawah, subhanAllah. And he currently leads the field Dawah department of Why Islam and 877 Why Islam, the Dawah and outreach project of ICNA in that area, alhamdulillah. All right, with that, inshallah, everything is with him. You guys will see me later. Assalamu alaikum.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Bismillah, alhamdulillah, wa salatu wa salam ala rasulillah, wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa man wala. All praise is due to Allah, and may the finest peace and blessings of Allah be upon all his prophets and messengers alike, including Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So dear respected brothers, sisters, friends who are tuning in to this lovely program organized by ICNA, jazakumullah khair for tuning in, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless the platform and all the speakers prior to and speakers to come. So I was basically recommended to speak on the topic of bringing Islam to small towns. What an interesting, unique topic, I would say, in light of the Dawah Reimagined theme. So ICNA, as you may know, has been focused on larger cities, so conveying and propagating the message of Islam to larger domains. But what about the rural areas? Okay, what about those areas where Islam may not be known, or those areas where we may be intimidated to approach? Who will deliver the message of Islam to such people? Surely Why Islam and ICNA has a 24/7 hotline. Surely we can send out letters and what have you to different zip codes. But what about the physical one-to-one human-to-human interaction, face-to-face interaction? How will you humanize with a person? How will you deliver the intellectual and compassionate message of Islam for what it's actually for? So in order to deliver the authentic message of Islam in the most compassionate manner, you want to be able to relate to people, to meet people, to engage with people. And so ICNA has focused in this very regard in doing this very initiative, which is to approach rural areas, to go to locations where Islam isn't known, where Islam is seen as alien, perhaps even barbaric, perhaps, you know, disliked. Whatever you see in the media as we find it today, we want to go to those locations and make sure that it's the authentic message of Islam is delivered and is available, and not the distorted, hijacked version of Islam as you find in the media sources and external sources. And so the purpose of these road trips that we've embarked on in the past year or two have been really purposed to reach such people in these rural areas, these small towns, and deliver the message of Islam. Additionally, it was also, as a second dimension, it was also targeted to empower and build that confidence and motivation within our own Muslim communities in those locations. I'm going to be sharing with you some chronicles and some tales basically of some of the road trips that we went on, inshallah. But we need to understand from the Islamic perspective why it's important to actually go to such locations. So conveying the message of Islam, obviously, per the Quranic discourse, is very clear. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Al-Imran in chapter 3, verse 104, وَلْتَكُمْ مِنْكُمْ أُمَّةٌ يَدَعُونَ إِلَى الْخَيْرِ وَيَأْمُرُونَ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ وَيَنْهَوْنَ عَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ وَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْمُفْلِحُونَ. That let there arise from you a nation, a small group, a community. The Mufassirun differ on what the exact word of the وَلْتَكُمْ مِنْكُمْ أُمَّةٌ يَدْعُونَ, this word, the Mufassirun differ, but either way, it either means a nation, a community, a small group. Let there arise from you a small group, a nation, a community that will enjoin in good and forbid evil. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says afterwards, وَأُولَئِكَ هُمُ الْمُفْلِحُونَ, that surely they are the successful one. Verily, they are the successful ones. So I think the message of Islam when it comes to da'wah is super clear in the Quranic discourse. And of course, just a few verses down in verse 110 of Surah Al-Imran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, كُنْتُمْ خَيْرَ أُمَّةٍ أُخْرِجَتْ لِلنَّاسِ, that you are the best nation. تَأْمُرُونَ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ, you enjoin in good. وَتَنْهَوْنَ عَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ, you forbid evil. And then you believe in Allah. Okay? وَتُؤْمِنُونَ بِاللَّهِ, and you believe in Allah. So da'wah is very clear in the Quran. Additionally, just one more verse to really hit the nail on the head. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah An-Nahl in verse 125, اُدْعُوا إِلَى سَبِيلِ رَبِّكَ بِالْحِكْمَةِ وَالْمَوْعِذَةِ الْحَسَنَةِ وَجَادِلْهُمْ بِالَّتِي أَحْسَنَ, that call or invite people to the way of your Lord with wisdom and beautiful preaching and reason with them. Of course, not in a derogatory way, but in a compassionate, intellectual manner. And so how will you reason with people? How will you convey the message of Islam? How will you actually humanize and connect with people? I mean, surely, like I mentioned, you can send brochures and Qur'ans and mail those materials to people, but you won't have that face-to-face interaction. So in the road trips that we've embarked upon, I'll cover two road trips. We actually went on two road trips back-to-back in 2019 prior to COVID. So prior to COVID, the COVID situation, we first went on a road trip. We called it the Northeast Road Trip, Dawah Road Trip. And this road trip was interesting because we're from the Northeast ourselves. So in this road trip, Alhamdulillah, we actually, it was a 5-day road trip. We started on August 1st and then ended on August 5th, Alhamdulillah. So on August 1st, we started in Harrisburg, Pennsylvania. You know, we met at the YSLAM Center. We had about 10 volunteers, Alhamdulillah, in one or two of the YSLAM vans. We drove up to Harrisburg, Pennsylvania. And then from there, we went to Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, then to Columbus, Ohio, down to Lexington, Kentucky, and then down further to Knoxville, Tennessee, and even more down further to Charlotte, North Carolina. And then we went back to Virginia and Maryland and back all the way up to New Jersey. So some highlights of this road trip include, for instance, when we were at Harrisburg, Alhamdulillah, believe it or not, our first stop, our norm was to deliver a dawah workshop in one of the local masajids or communities, and then following right afterwards, we would actually bring some of the locals there, our Muslim brothers and sisters, to join us in either the downtown location or a set location, a designated location that we had already pre-planned to conduct dawah. And so we conducted a dawah workshop, just a basic training on the do's and don'ts and some tips when you convey the message of Islam to the non-Muslim community. And then we went out to the downtown location in Harrisburg. As soon as we parked, we met a Baptist lady. You know, she actually confronted us, asked about our van, and then we had an intellectual, interesting dialogue on Islam. And within just a matter of a few minutes, brothers and sisters, she accepted Islam. You know, she was raised Baptist, but it never really stuck to her, the idea of the Trinity, the idea that, you know, God was anthropomorphic. He came down as man, as a man figure. So that never really stuck with her. So what seemed to have stuck with her more is Islamic monotheism, the belief in the one true God. In that same day, as a matter of fact, perhaps like an hour or two afterwards, we met a couple at Harrisburg, Pennsylvania, while we were conducting dawah. Both the husband and the wife accepted Islam right on the spot. And it was really interesting because it seemed like they were predisposed to Islam. And even they themselves, by their own admission, admitted to it. Which is interesting because the Prophet ﷺ said in the authentic hadith, كُلُّ مَوْلُودٍ يَوْلَدُ عَلَى الْفِطْرَةِ, that every son of Adam, every child is born in an innate disposition, a natural inclination to believe in God, to believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So they didn't hesitate and they accepted Almighty Allah, the one true God, and they accepted the message of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam on the spot. So Harrisburg, Pennsylvania has a really small Muslim community. So right after Harrisburg, we moved on with our trip. We went to Pittsburgh. Now, Pittsburgh was really interesting because, believe it or not, brothers and sisters, we encountered a 70-plus-year-old Caucasian man who has never met a Muslim in his life. Literally has never encountered a Muslim face-to-face. And it was pretty interesting because, you know, I had a brother with me who was wearing, you know, Alhamdulillah, the brother was wearing a full thobe. He was wearing a kufi while giving dawah. Of course, you know, we all dressed how we liked. Not all of us dressed in that manner, but he dressed in a very Islamic attire. So then I asked this elderly gentleman, and I asked him, what is your thought? You know, someone who's never met a Muslim, what is your initial thought when you saw my friend here? And he said, honestly, I was intimidated, and the first thing that came to my mind was terrorism. And so it really, it really shook me because it made me realize that here's a person who is more than 70 years old, born and raised in the States, in the United States, and he has never encountered or met a Muslim in his life. And it made me think, what are we doing? You know, what are we doing? What are we not doing enough of? Right? And it made me feel at home. It made me feel right in the right place, essentially. And so, you know, in just a short conversation, obviously he didn't, you know, necessarily believe that Muslims are terrorists, but he realized that, you know, that he took a college course back in the day, as he was explaining to me. And in this college course, he was learning about propaganda, and he feels that he may have been a victim of that himself. So he didn't agree with the media narrative, and instead he accepted a free copy of the Quran. So the point is, in going to such small towns like Harrisburg and Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, you meet folks who have never encountered a Muslim, and rather are actually, on the contrary, are actually scared of Muslims. They're fearful, they're intimidated by Muslims, by Islam, because of course, all the propaganda and all of the inaccurate information on Islam out there. So then after that, we went to Columbus, Ohio. In Columbus, we actually met a good partner of White Islam. The team is called Ask a Muslim, as you may know them. And we delivered an interactive workshop in that community. And then we took the White Islam and Ask a Muslim team, and we went to a local state park in the Columbus, Ohio area. Alhamdulillah, very amazing community, very receptive community. From there, we went down to Knoxville, Tennessee. And as a matter of fact, prior to us reaching Knoxville, we stopped in at Lexington, Kentucky, at Masjid Ibn Rabah, and we made Salah there. We met a brother who was actually involved in Dawah. He was telling us how, you know, it's a very Islamophobic community. You know, you have a lot of what we call, you know, rednecks and what have you, very Islamophobic folks there. But he said, you know, they do their best to convey the message, but, you know, they're limited in resources, they're limited in manpower. So this is also one of the things that we try to do, is we try to empower the community there, whether it's building confidence, whether it's providing the materials, you know, materials such as this, the clear Quran, for example. We offer them books of the Quran. We offer them brochures if they need it. So this is also part of the objectives in these dawah road trips, is not just to, and bringing Islam to small towns isn't just about speaking to people and engaging with people, but rather building a structure there, right? Building a base, in a sense. So if you have a Muslim community, brothers, sisters, youth who are active and empowered and interested and have that zeal to want to conduct dawah in their locality, then surely we should be making ourselves available at least as a resource. And that's what we've been trying to do, is bring it to the local small towns. Finally, we went to Charlotte, and in Charlotte, very interesting, we came across a Christian debater. We had a preacher, rather, and then we had an interesting conversation with him. Just to summarize the second road trip, because time is very short, the second road trip actually occurred in the last days of December, December 27th of 2019 to January 1st of 2020. And then there, we actually went to the Southwest now. So we went to the West Coast, we went to California, we went to Arizona, and we went to Las Vegas. And alhamdulillah, you know, we encountered some, again, really interesting people. A lot of people were receptive and supportive of Islam, but then you had other people who weren't. For example, when we went to Kingman, Arizona, one of the most Islamophobic communities in the United States, we went there, and then we encountered, as soon as we got there, you know, it's an area where you see tumbleweed and cowboy hats and things like that. But as soon as we arrived to the downtown location, we had a guy come up to us. He owns a pawn shop, and he said, honestly, you know, what are you guys doing here? I feel like you guys are here to kill me. So, of course, you know, we were caught off guard. You know, and many would say these kind of trips are somewhat dangerous. In reality, the majority of people were very personable and friendly and welcoming, with very strong hospitality. But you had a few folks, a few hotheads, and a few individuals who were questioning our presence and what we're doing here and so on. So anyway, this guy who owns a pawn shop, we had a talk with him in Kingman, Arizona, and in his local area. And within just a few moments, you know, we had explained to him that, you know, his information is obviously inaccurate. Here's a copy of the Quran. And he actually accepted it. He spoke to us. And I said, you know, just like you would have the KKK in Christianity, you can't represent Islam based on a few black sheep individuals, right? You have to look at the source. You don't want to fall into what we call the genetic fallacy. Don't reject the religion based on some actions of some individuals who claim to represent the religion or the faith. So I think that really made sense to him, and he accepted a copy of the Quran, and he moved on, alhamdulillah, and we also moved on. So we went to a lot of locations, brothers and sisters, just to summarize. And alhamdulillah, it's been a blessing to join people in this regard with our volunteers. And I thank you all for your time. Jazakumullah khair. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless all these efforts and continue to keep us going on this journey. Wa jazakumullah khair.